Dr. Marvin Beener is surrounded by reminders of a 30-year career in his clinic offices at Black Hills OBGYN. His goal has been to improve women's health. But after delivering around 9,000 babies, as he begins his retirement, he worries about the future.
With the syphilis epidemic and so many people, native and non-native, not getting adequate prenatal care, we're seeing lots of high-risk cases, which then also makes it much harder on the remaining physicians and is an incentive for them to get out of obstetrics, which is exactly what's happening.
South Dakota has the worst syphilis rate in the nation. It can lead to a range of health issues and is associated with high rates of miscarriage, stillbirth, and increased morbidity and mortality after birth. With Beener's retirement, there are now 6 obstetricians in Rapid City. He says that's about half the number of several years ago. He points to the state's abortion ban for creating a hostile climate for OBGYNs.
It's just a completely horrible, untenable situation that nobody wants to be in. And why would anybody come here willingly when they know that that's going to be the case?
Beener says his retirement only adds to the shortage.
And I tried very hard to find buyers for my clinic, both private and healthcare systems, and was unsuccessful. It's hard to recruit to Rapid City, even though it's a beautiful area, but it's so remote.
He says abortion bans that criminalize aspects of women's healthcare discourage providers, especially obstetricians, from moving to the state. Beener says the state's abortion law makes it hard to treat patients with complicated pregnancies.
And at what point do we let the situation go forward with infection or whatever before we can say that, oh, this is to save the life of the mother, to end this pregnancy? That's not clear cut. The legislature, the government, the governor, nobody has given us guidelines.
I'm Jackie Hendry, and this is SDPB's Unplanned Democracy, the story of South Dakota's third vote on abortion in 2 decades. While some say the language in South Dakota's abortion law is unclear, the consequences are not. Doctors accused of providing an unlawful abortion can face felony charges, up to 2 years in prison, and loss of their medical license. The so-called trigger law went into effect in 2022 when the Supreme Court overturned the constitutional right to a legal abortion. Since then, attempts to clarify the law have stalled.
We'll move on to House Bill 1169, authorize the performance.
Republican Representative Taylor Rehfeldt from Sioux Falls works as a nurse. In 2023, she introduced a bill to clarify provisions in the abortion law, to spell out the medical situations where abortion can be used legally to preserve the life of the pregnant female. Rehfeldt also added health exceptions for, quote, irreversible physical impairment of one or more major bodily functions.
My life matters. A woman's life matters. We were pro-women before Roe v. Wade was overturned, and we are still pro-women afterwards. I am here to tell you that there are people that care about women, that care about them deeply, and I will continue to fight for that. I trust that in this next year that we can work toward language that will allow people to know what the law actually means.
For Rehfeldt, the work was personal. She was pregnant at the time and considered at high risk because of an earlier stroke. But the bill failed to make it out of committee. A few weeks later, Rehfeldt and fellow nurse and lawmaker Senator Aaron Tobin, both Republicans, draft another bill. They want to refine the law's life of the mother exceptions. They hope to work with anti-abortion advocates on the measure, but their efforts fail, and the state's trigger law remains.
Senator Aaron Tobin and Senator.
In the very next election, an anti-abortion group donates money to Senator Tobin's primary opponent. Tobin loses by 48 votes.
Hi, I'm Secretary of Health Melissa Magstead. This video is required by law to provide you information about recent changes to South Dakota laws. South Dakota law does prevent.
Next comes an effort to clarify the state law that lawmakers and anti-abortion lobbyists do support. It comes in the form of a video. The prime sponsor of the video bill is Representative Rehfeldt. She tells fellow lawmakers the goal is clear language for medical professionals.
This bill is intended to take the political nature of that outside and not have it be a part of this bill. This bill is solely about taking care of moms and taking care of babies, and also making sure that providers have that clarification that they've asked for so that they know how to take care of women best.
But the Department of Health consults with the American Academy of Pro-Life OBGYNs on the video. Health Secretary Magstadt introduces a term, maternal-fetal separation, that's associated with that group when talking about life-threatening complications before a fetus is viable.
More rarely, such complications occur prior to fetal viability, but a maternal-fetal separation is still legal in these circumstances, even when the foreseen but unintended consequence is a fetal or neonatal death.
The American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology calls the phrase maternal-fetal separation misleading. It says the phrase lets abortion opponents suggest there's a procedure that differs from abortion.
This video was supposedly for medical providers, so we should be using medical terms.
Dr. Amy Kelly is an OBGYN in Sioux Falls. She says clarity is important in the medical field. Kelly recently described the video as helpful, but not enough. She says the list of a dozen conditions that would allow a doctor to perform an abortion legally is not comprehensive.
It's still a little wishy-washy, honestly. And medicine kind of is. You know, I mean, medicine is not, sometimes it's textbook, but most of the time it's not. Patients don't follow textbooks.
Kelly says the video does not address two primary concerns with the state's abortion law. First, what does it mean to procure an abortion, which is prohibited? And second, what should doctors do when they encounter severe fetal anomalies, birth defects, and pregnancies that put a mother's life at risk? Is it legal for them to refer those patients for treatment that could include an abortion? Kelly says that's concerning for obstetricians who could face a Class 6 felony charge from the state's abortion ban. Kelly, along with Rapid City's Dr. Biener, supports the abortion ballot question Amendment G that enshrines a trimester framework into the state constitution. Supporters call it the Freedom Amendment. If Amendment G passes, it allows abortion in the first trimester and accepts some abortion restrictions as a pregnancy progresses. The state can regulate abortion in the second trimester, but only in ways that are, quote, reasonably related to the physical health of the pregnant woman. In the third trimester, the state can prohibit abortions, except when abortion is necessary, quote, in the medical judgment of the woman's physician to preserve the life or health of the pregnant woman. Rick Weiland is the primary backer of the ballot question.
You're talking about health care, reproductive health care. And women who, have difficult pregnancies should have some options. Women who, get raped and become pregnant should have some options. And, pregnancies as a result of incest, those people should have some options. They have no options right now in South Dakota. Zero options.
Weiland has a history of bringing ballot initiatives to the public for a vote. His network stems from a 2014 run for U.S. Senate as a Democrat. Since then, he's leveraged political wedge issues to raise money for several ballot questions, focusing on a number of issues. Weiland says Amendment G could help South Dakota women access reproductive care.
It's a powerful, extremely important, critical opportunity to right the ship here in South Dakota. When you're dealing with the most extreme abortion ban in the country.
South Dakota is one of 13 states with total abortion bans. Weiland points to the women in his family, his two daughters of reproductive age, his 11-year-old granddaughter, wife, sisters, nieces, aunts.
And I just think it's just so unfair that, they've been told they have no options. And we're going to change that. We really are going to change that.
Opponents of the abortion ballot initiative call the measure too extreme. They say providing access to abortion in the first trimester and limited access in the second upends years of legislative work designed to protect women and unborn babies.
This has been a fundamental argument for so long.
Republican Brock Greenfield served in the state Senate and House from 2000 to 2022 with a front-row seat to South Dakota abortion policy debates. He's helped shepherd some of the state's restrictions. Greenfield says the state's abortion law aims to give every life a chance. He says the ballot question will reverse that.
Whether you like it or not, the words that are being proposed to the people in this constitutional amendment provide no regulation authority on the part of the state. You want to have a very profoundly unsafe practice. Put this in our Constitution and don't allow the people that come to work for you in the legislature to even have an impact on that. This allows for abortion up to the moment of birth.
Backers of Amendment G deny that it allows for abortion up to the moment of birth. The amendment language does allow the state to prohibit abortion in the third trimester. However, Greenfield says there's a gaping hole in the language of the ballot question. It's the phrase health exceptions.
Well, anytime health exception is available to the legal realm, they say that involves pretty much anything and everything, including if a person says, I'm not financially stable enough to rear a child at this point, raise a child, whether it be a single mother, whether it be a family. That has been construed to be a health exception.
Regardless of why a woman seeks out an abortion, few do so late in their pregnancy. The Kaiser Family Foundation is a nonprofit, independent health research organization. Its data suggest a significant minority, only 1% of women, seek an abortion after 21 weeks of pregnancy. That's roughly halfway through. At that point, abortions are rare and often difficult to obtain as they are only available in a handful of states. Prior to the abortion ban, the South Dakota Department of Health only tracked abortion up to the end of the first trimester. From 2014 to 2022, fewer than 10% of abortions came after 13 weeks, the exception being 2020, which was 11%. After the break, we hear from two women who've spent their lives on opposite sides of the abortion question in South Dakota.
SDPB's Unplanned Democracy is made possible with your membership to Friends of SDPB and the Report South Dakota Fund, with additional support from Wrench Law in Rapid City, lawyers defending South Dakotans since 1992. Learn more at wrenchlaw.com. Watch Denise Ross's 2008 documentary Unplanned Democracy on SDPB's YouTube page.
I'm Jackie Hendry, and this is SDPB's Unplanned Democracy. When Kelsey Pritchard was in high school, she was in a really bad relationship.
I was a teenager, and it was a verbally abusive relationship. It could have been physically abusive.
At one point, Pritchard says her partner thought she was pregnant.
And he was pressuring me to have an abortion, and that was not consistent with my values and what I wanted. And he told me, Kelsey, you would have to have this abortion because you would die if you wouldn't have this abortion. And I remember feeling really scared.
Pritchard wasn't pregnant, but says she might have been talked into an abortion because of the abusive relationship and how scared she was. Pritchard became a leader in Students for Life at Dakota Wesleyan University in Mitchell. Now 36, she's the state public affairs director with Susan B. Anthony Pro-Life America, one of the nation's leading anti-abortion groups. Pritchard's story is emblematic of what South Dakota's anti-abortion groups have sought to prevent. Behind many of those efforts was the advocacy work of Leslie Unruh.
And I've been involved in helping bring the legislation to peer and letting the legislators know what women go through personally, because that's the side that's never heard. Like in my situation, I was born with Wolf's Parkinson White. It was a heart, congenital heart defect. And so it affected pregnancies for sure. And so no doctor really wanted to deal with that back then.
A few years later, Unruh received treatment for her heart defect and was able to become a mother.
I just feel like women aren't told everything. And I don't think they even back then knew everything. But we do now. And so now it's become just a political thing, and women have been forgotten, especially those who maybe are being coerced by someone. They aren't making the decision themselves.
For 40 years, Unruh says she's devoted her life to helping women. She runs an abortion recovery program open to any woman who has had an abortion. Unruh says attendees are not judged and are met with love. Politics stay out of it. Unruh was heavily involved in the 2006 and 2008 abortion ballot questions, just as she is in 2024. She says abortion hurts women.
We really program South Dakotans like, it's you decide. When really the woman is pressured by whatever life situation she's in. It might be financial, it might be physical, it might be for whatever reason. She wants input, she wants help. And then she can decide based on all the help she should be getting.
Unruh acknowledges that the number of abortions nationally has gone up since the Dobbs decision. Much of that comes from an increased use of medication abortion, which can be mailed to patients in states with abortion bans. In 2020, research conducted by a branch of the University of California followed 1,000 women over 10 years and found those denied an abortion also struggled to afford food, housing, and transportation. The Turnaway study found those women were also more likely to experience physical violence from their partner and more likely to raise children alone. The same study shows 95% of women report that having an abortion was the right decision for them 5 years after the procedure. Casey Mershall has also spent decades on the front line of South Dakota's abortion debate, advocating for abortion rights. The former Republican lawmaker attended the University of South Dakota in the late 60s and early 70s. She recalls a homecoming parade acknowledging a new era of birth control for women in America.
Our sorority's float was a big old shoe. It was, there was an old woman who lived in a shoe, had so many children she didn't know what to do. So we had this big, huge shoe and a little paper mache balloony size head sticking out all over it. And along the side was, have you had your pill today?
Mershall graduated from college the year the Supreme Court ruling in Roe v. Wade gave women the right to legal abortion. Now 73, she's watched the arc of abortion law in America, serving for a time as South Dakota director of NARAL, an abortion rights organization.
I cannot believe we are still doing this, that there is anybody out there who says that women can't be trusted to make their own decisions about their bodies, their own bodies, and what's good for them and what's not. And will men and women always make mistakes? Is there anybody out there who wouldn't say, oh my God, when I was 20, if I only knew, I wouldn't have done X? Well, sure. But we don't take that right away from them. But we take rights away from women.
Anti-abortion forces continue to protect state restrictions and bans. The constitutional amendment has faced a lawsuit questioning the validity of more than 55,000 signatures placing the measure on the November ballot. It's likely, even after South Dakota residents vote on Amendment G, anti-abortion forces in the state legislature and advocates will offer challenges in the courts. For now, the big question is, how will South Dakota residents vote? And will they reject abortion restrictions for a third time? Lee Struvinger wrote, reported, and produced this episode, with reporting help from Lori Walsh. Kate Smith edited the script. Matthew Hancock wrote our music and mixed this episode. Josh Chilson is our news director. Kara Hetland, our director of journalism. Twyla Olson is our director of content. SDPB's executive director is Julie Overgaard. Special thanks to the late Denise Ross, who originally reported and produced the documentary Unplanned Democracy, and to her husband, David Larson, who allowed SDPB to use her audio and reporting for this project. You can watch the full Unplanned Democracy documentary on SDPB's YouTube page. Be sure to check out more at sdpb.org. Please rate and review the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. I'm Jackie Hendry. This is SDPB's Unplanned Democracy.